So, a very good evening to all of you, and welcome to the third webinar today on the managing losses via visual control. As earlier, we have shared with you that it is a joint initiative by Ori University and Skilltelligent to come up every week and share some information on the various techniques and tools used in industry for enhancing the productivity. And this is today's session is the third in such a series on managing losses via visual control. Majority of the big losses in manufacturing, that is equipment failure, setup and adjustments, idling and minor stops, reduced speeds, process defects and reduced yields, these all can easily be visually traced with a well-designed visual management and visual control systems. Today's session will primarily focus on overview of losses in manufacturing, various visual controls, leveraging visual controls to manage losses. So these three basic aspects would be primarily covered in this webinar. Let me brief you very shortly about the Ori University. Ori University, established in the year 2011, is the first university in the country focusing on the integral and transformational learning inspired by the philosophy of Sri Aurobindo's vision of integral education. It offers undergraduate, postgraduate, and PhD degrees under its various schools like School of Business, School of IT, School of Law, School of Hotel Management, Mass Communication and Journalism, Liberal Arts, Design, and we would shortly be starting our School of Sciences. Let me also brief you about the Skilltelligent. Skilltelligent is engaged in the business of providing quality, skilling, and reskilling solutions to employed industrial workforce. Skilltelligent has executed many assignments to improve the skills of shop floor workers, their productivity, competency, work-related interpersonal communication skills, as well as for training to establish manufacturing best practices. And today we have Mr. Atul Garg with us. Mr. Atul Garg is the director of the Skilltelligent. He is the past chairman of CII Gujarat State Council and has been on several regional and national committees of CII. He has more than three decades of experience in the IT industry and has built several software products in his earlier company. He is also certified Safe Agile Coach. He has extensive experience in manufacturing systems, processes, and building competencies in shop floor teams. So with this short brief, may I welcome to our today's speaker, Mr. Atulji. Sir, over to you.
Thank you, Kishore. Am I audible?
Yes, sir.
So thank you, Kishore, once again, and good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I think manufacturing is now increasingly becoming digital and visual. Factories are now increasingly becoming are being set up or transformed into visual factories or workplaces. Factory managers are setting up visual controls to identify the manufacturing losses. It helps them to reduce the manual tracking and supervision. And if electronic visual controls are used, it also helps them to get alerts instantaneously. Today, we are going to focus on how visual controls can help in managing production losses. And in this session, this is going to be targeted at the production managers, shop floor leaders, and HR heads. Our discussion topics today are, number one, what are the big losses in manufacturing? Second, what are the visual controls? Third, we will also take a case study and discuss that. Over a period of time, we have found that case studies actually help in understanding the topic better. We will also talk about how do you map the visual controls to loss areas and how do you leverage the visual controls for managing the losses. So, majority of the losses, big losses in manufacturing, if you look up, they are equipment failure, setup and adjustments, idling and the minor stops, reduced speeds, process defects, reduced yields, and so on. These all losses can be visually traced with a very well-designed visual management visual control system. These losses, as I talked about, they are, first one is a breakdown. It could be anything to do with the tooling failure and so on. It could be setup and adjustments. Every time you have to set up a machine for a new job, that also results into some kind of a loss. If in the beginning or during the entire execution, if the machine is not running to the rated capacity, then that's a reduced speed loss. And then you have the production rejections, you also have the startup rejections, and you also have the small or the minor stops which may happen while the job is going. So these are the kind of the losses which we generally talk about. Let's go in the detail of each of them. So we talked about the six major losses, and I'm going to take each one of them one by one, so that once we understand these losses, we can talk about that what kind of the visual controls can be set up for them. So the first one is equipment failure, and it can be tooling failure, it could be unplanned maintenance, general breakdown, or overall equipment failure. The second loss is a setup and adjustments, which covers the equipment availability loss due to setup or changeover, material and or operator shortages, major adjustments being done while setting up the machine, or any kind of a warm-up time. So these are the various losses. The third loss is reduced speed. Any kind of a rough running or any underrated performance or any kind of a equipment wear and tear or operator inefficiency can also lead to the reduced speed. The fourth defect is the process defect or process loss, and it is characterized by the generation of a scrap, rework, in-process damage, in-process expiration, or incorrect assembly. Reduced yield is fifth one, and it is pretty similar to the process defects, except that it happens at the startup time. The sixth one is the idling and the minor stops, and this can be because of the obstructed product flow, component jams, misfeeds, sensors block, cleaning and checking, etc., and so on. So these are the six major losses which in the lean manufacturing we focus on. We usually map the six big losses to the equipment total available time. And we see over here, our overall available time is determined by the planned downtime. That is, if we have the machine for 100 hours or for 24 hours, and if the planned downtime is 2 hours, then our available time is 22 hours. So we go as the available time determined by the planned downtime. This leaves us along with the available operating time, and that can further reduce down by the breakdowns or setup and adjustments. After the setup and adjustments or any breakdowns, the time left is actually the operating time, which again could be constrained by the idling and minor stoppages or maybe even the reduced speed. So the effective operating time can further now, whatever is left out, could also be further impacted by the reduced productivity due to defects in process and rework or startup losses. So if you see over here, essentially your six big losses can substantially reduce your available time to run the machine. And that's what we need to monitor, and that's what we need to focus out. Okay. A quick refresher on OEE. OEE, or overall equipment efficiency, is nothing but the ratio of fully productive time to planned production time. It tells us how well a manufacturing operation is utilized compared to its own full potential. And we usually focus upon availability, performance, and quality as the OEE calculations over here. So let's map the three types of the losses: availability loss, performance loss, and quality loss to the OEE overall. So since OEE focuses on availability, performance, and quality losses, we map the equipment failure and setup and adjustment to availability loss, idling and minor stops with reduced speed to performance loss, and process defects and reduced yields to the quality losses. These are the original words which are being used over here. These are the new names which are being used for the traditional six big losses. So what are visual controls? This slide, I'm going to skip it, though it is a fantastic representation of a visual factory. And it does talk about the various sensors, endons, kind of the data collections happening, automation happening, whatever is happening, the representation of that on a dashboard and so on. So it's a good picture of a visual factory. But since right now we are not focusing on visual factory, we will move on. Visual factory probably is a topic which will add up into some another going forward. So I'm sure that you would have noticed that in the recent years, we have the visual signs all around us. Whether you go on the road or you go in a mall or a public building like an airport, railway station, everywhere you will find a lot of visual signs. And these visual signs actually reduce the need to ask for any directions or any information from the others. So they become the self-explanatory and they help you to, you know, understand what you want to know. So for an example, over here, if you want to know where is the toilet, you know, this sign itself tells you that you have to go straight forward to east of the toilet. Or this sign tells you that a straightforward road will take you to Dehradun, Kanpur, Bihar and Ghaziabad. Maybe if there is a divergence somewhere, then it will tell you a different arrow and tell you that where it will take you. So these are, you know, the all visuals which are kind of existing. Road signs also tell us that if there is a speed breaker, where it is, or where a turn is expected, where it will lead you, and so on and so forth. So we are all surrounded by the visuals now. So how do we talk about the visual workplace? A visual workplace will be characterized by the two prominent perspectives. First, it has the visual management in place, which is designed to be self-explaining. And visual management is a system for situational awareness enhancement. People feel very comfortable only if the issues are clear up front. So visual management enables them to see the issues very clearly. The second character of a visual workplace is the presence of the visual controls. The visual controls organize the working area in such a way that people can tell whether things are going well or something is not right. So you just walk in, if you are able to walk onto a floor and within a matter of minutes, you are able to determine then what is the status of the operation, then that means that you have a good visual controls in place and you don't have to ask around. It will actually tell you what is the status. So that is what the visual control is. In this webinar, we are going to remain focused on visual controls. We are not going to talk about the visual management because that's a larger topic. So we will take that maybe again in another webinar. So visual controls aim to increase the efficiency and effectiveness of a process by making the steps in that process more visible. If something is clearly visible or in plain sight, it's easy to remember and focus on it. So example, if we know that a specific machine is not working, we know that overall performance will be impacted. A visual indicator showing a machine downtime at that situation helps us to step in and take the corrective action. What are the benefits of the visual controls? So they have several benefits. They help in identifying problems to be solved, they reduce the manufacturing cost, they reduce the possible waste, shorten the production lead time, and even help in meeting the delivery dates. They also help in reducing inventory, ensure a safe and comfortable environment, and increase the company's profit. If a designated area is marked for holding the work in progress of a process with a specific quantity in mind, and actual material starts overflowing that area, it becomes visibly possible to notice the increased work in progress. And since now you can notice it, you can take the corrective action. So visual controls help out into these simple ways of, you know, taking the corrective actions. Sorry. Visual controls usually are of the four types, and I'll deal with all the four of them in a short. First is the identification. These visual controls, identification-based visual controls, help in identifying to tell what something is. It may seem obvious, but when you have hundreds of, let's say, unmarked boxes stacked up together, then there is no way to tell them what is inside them. But if you have a tag on top of it, it can help you to find out that what is into them. So they help you to identify. The second type is informative. The concept of an informative visual is that you can obtain important information from one location, such as the status update or latest on a current situation and so on and so forth. So that's an informative visual. The third one is instructional. So these are instructions in the forms of, let's say, lines on the shelves, signs, work instructions. And these are designed to ensure that there is an operational consistency. So these are the instructions which will help you to standardize the work as well as maintain the operational consistency. The fourth one is the planning. And the planning visual controls, they can be reliable, can be sort of the reliable offline forms of planning. Visual planning boards and quality circle boards are examples of it. You already get a lot of information from the system, and if this information is made available visually, then you can, you know, actually do a better planning. So these are the planning visual controls. Some examples here, what we have got is, let's say in the first one, we have got a storage location marked for a pallet, or there is a safety lockout system put in the place on a valve during the maintenance. There is a digital counter over here which is telling you that plan versus actual, what is the whole thing and what is the difference into what is actually achieved out over here. There are other types of the digital counters, meters and gauges. This is a color-coded kind of a stuff which is telling you that the red pin will go only in the red plug, it cannot go elsewhere. Or there is a information board over here where you can sit down, discuss, and you know, find out that what planning is to be done. These are the floor markings. These are also the markings to say that where you can travel, what is the pathway, and so on and so forth. So these are some of the examples of the visual controls. Let's take a case study, and then we'll go through each of these losses and the visual controls which can be put in the place. So let's take an example of a large machine shop which has several machining equipment. There can be, you know, this company has got maybe, you know, 300, 400 different types of the CNC machines and the lathes. And they also do the development and machining and the product manufacturing, component manufacturing for a large product mix. This means that since you have a large product mix, you have a also high number of setups and adjustment changes. Your idling and minor stops, thereby that increase, as well as, you know, since you have large number of machines, minor setups, though it may seem only 2 minutes per machine, but overall when you take the 300 machines over 24 hours, that number of hours into the minor stops can be substantial. There are also certain kinds of the process defects which are also leading to the reduced yields. So management over here decides that let's set up some kind of a visual control ranging from machine and on lights to the production control boards, area demarcation, zoning, floor marking, material compartmentalization, and so on and so forth, so that they can, you know, declutter the shop floor as well as control the production losses. So that's the kind of the, you know, scenario we have run into. So management decides to focus on five areas. First, let's declutter the shop floor. And then focus out on the four major losses. The first one being equipment failure. Second, setup and adjustment. Third, reduced speed. Fourth, idling and minor stops. So these are the five areas which they identify for implementing the visual controls to manage these losses. They realize that they can put up a proper visual control system over here, which can identify the failures or losses, inform about what is not right, provide instructions for avoiding the future failures, and be able to plan based on the information gathered. So these are the areas which they focus on. They mandate their production manager to set up the necessary visual controls over here. So our production manager feels the need to look up at, first of all, various losses and identify that what kind of the visual controls can be leveraged over here. Because it's not that I can just walk in and then put up any kind of a visual control and it will work. So he takes a systematic approach of, you know, identifying the relevant visual controls. So the first mapping which he does is for decluttering the shop floor. He identifies the two types of the losses over here. Low productivity and efficiency, and second one being the safety. So visual controls he identifies for the first one are storage and location markings to ensure that each material is in its designated place only. Floor marking for identifying various work areas, signs and labels to identify what is where, pathways to define the working area. He also defines and divides the entire shop floor into several zones, and each zone is for a specific purpose, so he can, you know, better manage those zones. For the safety, he decides to put up the safety signs, safety boards, safety lights and the sirens, etc. So these are the kind of the visual controls he identifies for his shop floor decor. So these are some of the examples. This is all about zoning. So he did some kind of the zoning over here, saying that this is inspection area, this is matching area, this is shipping area, this is receiving area, and so on and so forth. And his layout of the machine, he again, you know, shop floor starts identifying what will happen where, what will go where, and so on and so forth. They also define the color coding to be, you know, put into the place, so that what kind of the color will denote what. So for an example, goods held for inspection will be marked with the orange color, but all the defects, scraps and other things will be by the red color, and yellow will be only for the aisleways and the traffic lanes and so on. So he defines, you know, all these color codes to establish it. Okay. He also identifies once again that how the pallets will be stored, how to identify them. He puts the signs and labels, identifies that what signs and labels can go on the racks, what kind of the layout will be done, what kind of the pathways will be defined, demarcation of area will be done, green identifying that this is, you know, in progress or finished goods, black, red, green, all these have certain, you know, denotions. And then he also puts up the various safety and signs. This one I have taken it for the hazardous safety signs, but he can also put up for the other areas. So that is what he does. Then the next which he does is that he takes up the other four losses which were identified for setting up the visual controls. So our production manager then identifies the equipment status lights, closed loop detection systems for getting informed about the equipment failure. He also identifies the graphs and charts as a tool for planning to reduce the equipment failure. For setup and adjustments, he decides to establish torque markings, various machine markings based on the pre-decided color coding, and include the visual instructions for the setup and adjustments. Downtime clocks and timers, machine add-ons, digital gauges and meters, production status boards, they are identified as necessary visual control tools for idling and minor stop losses. For the reduced speed monitoring, he puts up the production status board, equipment status lights, graphs and charts, and so on. So that is how he maps out to his losses the various visual control techniques which he can put into the place. So once again, these are some of the examples. So this is a visual instruction. This is a production status board, which is again talking about plan versus the target time. The gap over here, total time for which the entire operation is running. Previous shift actual. So there is a comparative available over here. This is a classical example of, you know, setting up a mark over here. So you know that how much you have to turn it to, what is the alignment you have to do while fixing it, or to, you know, how much screw has to be tightened up, and so on and so forth. So these are, you know, the torque markings and so on. He also sets up the end of boards. He also sets up, you know, the relevant closed loop detection systems and so on and so forth. He also puts up some control code based kind of the, you know, plugs and systems, again setting, you know, other boards which will tell him that things are happening, not happening, what is happening with this specific line and so on. And then again the lockout and takeout systems over here. So he puts up different kind of these systems, he maps them and says that this is what he would like to put it on over here. The other things which he puts up is, again, how will he organize the shop floor, so where the material will go, how to organize that. If the machines are there, what kind of the end-ons have to be put in, an error, color-coded error messaging system, which will tell them that what kind of the errors have come in, so he can, you know, quickly identify and act upon only the red ones and watch the yellow ones, green one is okay. So all those kind of the things he sets it up, identifies, and the visual controls to be set up for the managing the losses. So having said that, now he now he's at a stage where he wants to, you know, take it forward. So again, this is a representative image of a machine end-on where there are color-coded error messages displayed. If a particular machine is either malfunctioning or has a start, the lights will start flashing, indicating which machine is in a which stage, and a display board will define the what kind of the error is happening. So he goes ahead and then says that let's establish that. So what he does now, he does the reverse thing now. He maps all kind of the visual controls, having identified all the visual controls. He now maps them back, reverse, to the various losses which he wants to control. So over here, this rows are identifying the various visual controls he identified, starting from equipment status light, machine end-ons, downtime clock and timers, gauges and meters, production status boards, closed loop detection, torque marking, machine marking, and so on and so forth, digital counters, and so on and so forth. And on this side, he puts up that these will be used for the equipment failure, setup and adjustment failures, idle and minor, stopping, and so on and so forth. So that is how then he starts identifying. Okay. So let's go now one by one into each of them and say that, you know, how exactly he is going to use them. So we also understand that what the situation is and then what can be done about it. So cluttered workplace, that's the first thing which he wanted to focus upon. So if we take the cluttered workspace, it's nothing but a cluttered or overcrowded workplace. And overcrowded place is always known for generating material loss, high material tracking time, extra time taken to perform an activity, It also results into safety issues and overall degrades the productivity. So in other words, cluttered workplace leads to highly unorganized working and leads to productivity losses. So that's his first attack area where he wants to put in the visual controls to, you know, declutter it. So production manager, based upon the matrix he created on the types of losses and visual controls which can be set up, he decides to set up the shop floor pathways, carries out the zoning of the shop floor, does the storage and its location marking, and sets up the required signs and labels for the information. So that's his first set of the visual controls which he puts it over here. The second one which he focuses out is on the equipment failure. So how do you manage the equipment failures? So what is equipment failure? Normally, equipment failure will account for any kind of a significant period of time in which the equipment is scheduled for production but is not running due to a failure of some sort. Okay? Or more generalized way of thinking is that equipment failure is any unplanned stop or downtime. And equipment failure is nothing but an availability loss. Examples of the common reasons for equipment failures include the tooling failures, breakdowns, unplanned maintenance. From a broader perspective of unplanned stops, other common reasons could also include no operators or material, being starved by the upstream equipment, that is the, you know, the equipment before that is not able to produce enough to feed into this machine, and so on and so forth. So there is a flexibility on where to set the threshold between the equipment failure and a minor stop, because they both come, you know, very close to each other. So, but to us, the equipment failure is an availability loss, whereas a minor stop is a performance loss. Okay? So how do we distinguish? We set up a good rule of thumb, which says that threshold based on your policy for tracking results. So our policy could say that any downtime longer than 2 minutes should have a reason associated with it, and then thus it shall be considered as an equipment failure. So if we said that any minor stop cannot be more than 5 minutes, so if it is a 10-minute stop, that means there is a equipment failure. But if it is 5 minutes, then it could be a minor stop. So it depends upon our policy, which we set up over here. Okay. So in this particular case, for the equipment failure, he decides to set up the equipment status light or the end-on, production status board, downtime clock and timers, electronic status board, end-ons, lockout takeout controls, and these are the things which he uses to stay informed and also identify where the equipment failure has taken place. The next one he focuses upon is the setup and adjustment. And if you look, setup and adjustments account for any significant period of time if the equipment is scheduled for production but is not running due to a changeover or other equipment adjustment. We may have to, you know, change the die, we may have to change the design, we may have to change the material. So all that is a setup time or an adjustment to adjust the production. So a more generalized way to think of setup and adjustment is any planned stop. We plan for it that I need to change over the design. This results into availability loss. And if we take the examples of the common reasons, it will include setup, changeovers, major adjustments, tooling adjustments, and so on. And from a broader perspective of planned stops, other common reasons would include cleaning, warm-up time, plant maintenance, maybe even the quality inspections. So the largest source of setup and adjustment time is typically changeovers. And it can always be addressed through a SMAD kind of a thing to improve upon it. But we need to have the measurements to understand that what has been the actual stoppage over here. How much time it has taken to set up the new program. So again, over here, he chooses downtime clocks, machine status light, production status boards to monitor and control the setup and adjustment losses. If these controls are in place, it will help him to know how long the setup time has taken, whether it exceeded the standard time or not. If it has exceeded the standard time, then he can, you know, again take the corrective actions into this. So that is where he uses these kind of things. He can also use the graphs and charts, which will be based upon the data collected, which will tell him that a particular activity was as an internal activity, another was an external activity. So how you can bring the external activity into internal fold, and thereby that's reduce the time and or reduce the wait period while doing the setup time. So multiple tools he can use over here. I've just right now, in this case, studied the 4 or 5 over here as a relevant ones. Okay. He also sets up few other things again the visual instructions. Why the visual instructions? Because when his team is doing the setup, if there are visual instructions available, that will ensure that there is the consistency in the setup being done and you are achieving the standardization. Various gauges and other things you may use to monitor that, you know, your adjustments are correct, you are not, you know, over tightening or under tightening or increasing or decreasing the pressure than the required parameters. So that's why the, you know, the torque markings and the machine markings or the bolt markings and other things, they help out in saying that you are not over tightening, under tightening, you're not setting up the parameters other than, you know, what they should be. So that is what he talks about. The next we move on is to the reduced speed. So when the reduced speed comes in, this is something which accounts for time where the equipment runs slower than the idle cycle time. That is the theoretically fastest possible time the manufacturer has identified. Okay. Now, this also could be said that it is nothing but the slow cycles, and reduced speed always results into the performance loss. Examples of the common reasons for reduced speed could be dirty or worn out equipment, poor lubrication, substandard material, maybe poor environmental conditions, operator inexperience, startup and shutdown times, and so on. So this category of the reduced speed could include anything that keeps the process from running at its theoretically maximum speed when the process is actually running. So if it is slated to run at, let's say, 10 strokes per minute, but it is running only 5 strokes per minute, that means it is running at its reduced speed. So how do you monitor? How do you control that visually? So that's where he sets up, again, you know, various counters, various kinds of the end-on boards and various, you know, boards where he gets the figure that, okay, my rated speed was 30 instead of that, I'm right now running at 10 and there is a difference over here, or the counters can tell me other parameters simultaneously. Gauges can tell me that whether I'm in the optimum running speed range or not, and so on and so forth. And the end-ons, if it is an electronic machine or it has a good amount of electronic, it could also show you that it is not running at a proper throughput. So that also it can show you. So from a distance itself, you can make out that my machine is not working properly, I can intervene. So that is the reduced speeds. The fourth loss, which was identified to be improved upon and the visual controls to be set up, were the idling and minor stops. Now, idling and minor stops accounts for the time where the equipment stops for a short period of time. And this could be typically a minute or two, and with the stops resolved by the operator. And these are also called as the small stops. Again, this is a performance loss. Examples of these kind of the, you know, stops could be, the common reasons could be misfeeds, material got jammed, product flow has been obstructed, in settings have not been correct, there are misalignments or the sensors have been blocked, or there are design issues which are leading to, you know, some adjustments to be done by stopping the machine, or some kind of a periodic cleaning to be done when the machine is running. So these are the common reasons why you have a minor stop or an idling. Now, normally these kind of the things don't require a maintenance person, the operator themselves can take care of this thing. And these are usually chronic, that means the same problem can keep on repeating again and again, everyday basis. And sometimes the operator just takes this as a, you know, regular thing in his life. So he never, you know, reports them back saying that, oh, that was a minor thing, you know, something got stuck, so I had to just stop, clean it up and restart it. He doesn't realize that 10 times stopping it for 3 minutes is a 30 minutes in a 24-hour session or into a 12-hour shift, right? If there are 300 machines like this and they're stopping 20 times during the day, it's a 1 hour per machine, that's a 300 hours lost into the production. So it's very important that, you know, you monitor them and you try to find out that what these losses are. So if you have the visual controls in this, where every small stop is being calculated and is being, you know, tracked and is being displayed on a display board, electronic status board, or a board which tells me that, you know, this thing is underway, changeover, this is running okay, this is in maintenance, this one is under the small stopover, or things like this, then it helps in identifying that there is, you know, actually stop happening, and the data once recorded and captured It can also tell you later on that how many stoppages happened. Then you can actually look into them and try to resolve them. So these things again, you know, help you to control the various losses because of the idling and the minor stops. There are a few additional visual controls which also can be established over here. And one of those controls can be the planning boards, quality circle boards, various kind of, you know, the display boards, which will help you to interact and also understand that what is happening. You could even identify certain things, certain tools which are damaged, ineffective, or not, you know, proper to use, and you could detect them so that, you know, people don't pick up and use the wrong tools, and thereby that, you know, end up resulting into the you know, further downtime because a wrong tool was selected or used. There could be, we talked about this earlier, there could be better, you know, color coding. There could be color coding on the floor marking. You could also have the color coding on the pipings, your all kind of the equipments marking can be there. Your signages could be in the different color codes. When you store the material in and around the machine, that also could be color coded to identify that what type of a material this is, where to use it, and so on and so forth. So these kind of the other visual controls also can be brought in over here. They all help you to reduce the time which goes beyond into, you know, either the idling or into minor stops and setups or into any of these kind of things. So that is where, you know, these kind of the visual controls are used. So if we look back, visual controls actually help, right? Now the production manager, having put in these things, he actually is fully equipped to get early information as well as identify any kind of a loss which could be occurring at his shop. So even if a machine stops, his end-on light will start blinking red color or yellow color, whatever the status accordingly. And he can, you know, right from there itself, from a corner office, also see that which machine has started blinking green or red or yellow. And he can talk to that operator and or rather flag the operator that please look into it, or his supervisor can go and look into that. So machine status lights, production status boards, counters, downtime clocks, all these things tell him that if there is a equipment failure or there is a machine idling or there are minor stops. He also accordingly gets a lot of detailed insights, whether his setup and adjustment losses are under control, machines are running at the rated capacity or not. So these things, you know, help him to manage. By setting up the certain visual instructions, color-coded markings, for storage, locations, pathways, signs, labels, etc. He can ensure that his team is working more diligently. There are no errors in working, or there is a standardization of the work over there. So that's a, you know, visual instruction for information and for, visual control for giving the instructions. When you have so much of the data, and if these things are electronic, then definitely we'll get large number of data fed into your systems. And when this data starts coming in, then obviously it helps you into planning better. So now you know that what causes the extended time in setting it up. Now you know that what kind of the equipment failures have happened in the past and what should be done to avoid it. Now you know that, you know, why the operator stops the machine so often. So what can be done to avoid that particular thing? Now he knows that the material feed into his machine is not happening. That's why the operator is waiting. So he can do the line balancing and ensure that, you know, the material keeps flowing to his machine regularly and operator doesn't have to stop this entire thing. Right? So that is where, you know, this data starts, or these visual controls start helping him to plan better. And when he puts up this information on his planning boards, his team can review and identify the areas where the planning can improve the productivity. Now, also once he has the visuals, he has the signs, he has the signages, labels, markings, color coding, location setup, storage is defined. It also helps his workforce to know that what is lying where, and it helps them into reducing the search time. So if the search time is reduced, that also means that the operator really doesn't have to wait for the material and he doesn't have to put his machine on his farm. So all these kind of the things, you know, lead one to another and help him to control the losses on the shop. So that's what the visual controls effectively help. Now the production manager, having set up this entire thing, is in a better position to control his shop floor, take the proactive actions over here, right time intervene. His supervisors and his managers can right time intervene whenever there is some, you know, something going wrong, instead of coming to know after an extended period of time where he might have already lost quite some time, or maybe even, you know, the defects might have started increasing. So visual controls start helping him do that better. So what did we learn? Visual controls actually increase the efficiency and effectiveness of the process. Visual controls also ensure that whatever the steps are there into a process, they all become visible. So they are not hidden. You don't just see the end goal. You also see all the steps which are happening, and you see that each step, whether it is happening correctly. If that is visible to you, then obviously you can take the corrective actions very clearly. But if they're not visible to you, you will not be able to take the corrective action in time. So visual controls help you with that. If the visual controls are planned well, they can identify and inform on the losses in real time, and they let you plan for the corrective interventions even before the losses is happening. So that's what, you know, this visual controls help us into the overall thing. So in the end, if we see, visual controls are actually very powerful tools, and now they are being adopted across the world for improving efficiencies and productivity. If you go into a modern factory, you will be amazed by the amount of the digital counters and the digital TVs. They will be flashing a lot of information, but these kind of the things, they have to be designed well. Otherwise, you will, you know, get overwhelmed with too much of the information at coming at you, and you won't know that what is the right information to act upon. So that's where you have to really design out these visual controls against a particular purpose and against a particular, you know, focus area. Skilltelligent and Aura University, we can actually help you to train your production staff, your production managers, plant heads, and so on, to understand these visual controls, to plan them better. And if required, we can even help you to implement them same at your place also. So thank you everyone for participating. This is where I would like to end. Kishore, if we have any questions or anything, you know, coming up from the participants, we can definitely take them. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for such a wonderful presentation. You made the visual controls understanding so easy. It was presented in a very, you know, very clear way and very understandable way. Participants, if you have any questions, any doubts, you may please raise now. You can tell us. A few comments coming in, sir. There's a nice lecture. And someone says, Mr. Abdul, I really appreciate the contents. It is simple and absolutely clear for understanding.
Thank you. Really appreciate
there's
it.
One, yeah, question is coming. Sir, can you please help in improving visual controls in store management?
Sure. So, store management, or rather, I would broaden it up, store and inventory management. There are a variety of the visual controls which can be put in. So, signs and language, signs and labels is one to start with. Marking up all kind of your racks, your storage areas clearly, so that, you know, people know that a particular type of a material is stored where, they can directly go into that location, is one part which is part of the visual controls over there. If you have an ERP system or a store management system, you can say very clearly that a particular type of a ball bearing is stored into the aisle number 2, rack number 3, on the shelf number 6, and the bin number 2. Okay, so if you have that stored like that and you have that labeled, then when your MRP system tells you that where the material is located, it becomes very easy for you to find out that where that material is. So that's a one part of, you know, the visual control over there. The second thing which you can put in is the label controls. So you can always, you know, put up the label saying that my minimum label is marked over there as whatever yellow color, and if the material falls below that particular yellow label, that means you are into a trouble area. Okay. A green label could be marked to say that this is my optimum label which I am going to store. So you can always set up the label markings over there. You can always, you know, put up things like that. A large display which can actually tell you from the distance that which rack holds what is again another thing. If you remember, if you go into a mall, if you go into a superstore, right on the top itself, you can see where you can find the biscuits, where you can find the groceries, where you can find the various household items and so on and so forth. That's nothing but a visual control, which is helping you to find out that where do you need to go to find the soaps, or where do you need to go to find the plastic, you know, baskets or, you know, the boxes and so on and so forth. So the same thing applies even over here also. So these are some of the visual controls which can be put up into the stores. There's several of them which we can talk about. We can always, you know, take them up. If you have time later on, we can always add them.
So there is one more question coming. How to manage gain via visual control?
Could you repeat, please?
How to manage gain via visual control?
Manage gain?
Yes.
No, I didn't gain. Okay.
Basically, it is a measurement criteria. So how do you measure the visual control benefits?
Oh, okay. How do you measure the benefits of the visual control?
Yes.
What gains have been achieved?
Yes.
Okay. So it depends upon the type of the visual control you are putting in. Suppose if it is a visual control which is actually capturing the information in the actual units of time or activities or operations or something like that, and that tells you upfront that what kind of the activities have been carried out, and it is also able to calculate the difference between what was planned versus the actual, then you can always, you know, find out that how much your visual controls have helped out. The other ways in which you can find out the benefits of the visual control, or, you know, the benefit gains out of the visual control, is in terms of saying that how many safety incidences have gone down, how many times the minor stops could be avoided, okay, how many times the idling has been stopped over here, or how many times the equipment failure has led not to an extended downtime but a lesser downtime. The wait period to respond to a equipment failure has been reduced because the visual control told me upfront. So these are some of the ways in which you can find out that how effective visual controls have been and what kind of the return on investment these visual controls have given on their work. Okay. I hope I have clarified this to your satisfaction.
Yeah. There is one more question coming in. Is there any Indian standard to be implemented visual control at workplace? Is there any Indian standard to be implemented visual control at workplace?
There are several standards. There are Indian standards as well as the international standards. All the color coding which is done is following a particular set of a color standard. Each color to be put in over there has a purpose, and it also has a color code given to it, so that, you know, when you put up that color, it is matching everywhere. So there are color standards on that. Same way, even the piping color is also, there is a standard. Even into the various kind of the counters and so on, there are various standards which are followed. So yes, there are several Indian and international standards for the visual control. Even for the signage which you put in, the height and width of the signage based upon the location, the distance from which you will be looking up at it, accordingly the size of the characters or the letters into that, they all are standardized. So there are several standards which need to be followed up to be having an effective visual control. Okay.
There is one more question coming in. Can visual controls be part of 5S implementation?
Yes. So visual control, actually, you know, if you see the visual management, visual control and 5S, if they are implemented together, they produce better results in terms of managing and improving workplaces. They also help in improving the discipline in workforce, reducing the wastages and managing the losses. Usually you would actually start with the 5S and implement the basic visual management before attempting to establish the visual control for managing loss. So if you see, even in our case study, we first started by decluttering the shop floor, so which was nothing but a 5S effort. And then after that sorting and set in order is done, then you set up the visuals over there so that, you know, that can be maintained over there. And then after that, then you put in the visual controls over there. So 5S actually helps in implementing the visual control far better. So 5S, visual management and visual control, if done together, they produce the far better results.
Thank you. There is one more question coming in. What all can be presented on electronic production status boards?
Okay. All right. So electronic status boards, if they are electronic, then they actually would have the huge possibility of configuring them as per your requirement. And if these boards are connected to your ERP, then you can, you know, display huge amount of the data. So what you can display over there, you can display right from the target versus the actual production, number of machines working, speed achieved, to maybe even the total idle time or the downtime or the various warnings, error messages. If you have the ERP connected to this and there is an online data which is being assimilated and then, you know, made available, then you can even show the real-time graphs and trends of the various parameters, availability of the machine, performance of the machine, quality parameters, and so on and so forth. So you can actually, you know, configure the electronic production boards to multitude of the things based upon what exactly you are looking for managing your operation. So it's pretty much, you know, open-ended system and configurable to your design.
Yeah. Thank you. We are done with the questions. And it was truly a very informative session, sir. And we have received very good comments from the participants. And mostly they are asking to share the presentation. We can share with them the presentation.
Yeah, yeah, sure, sure. I believe this session is also being recorded on the YouTube.
Yes, yes.
So it is. We can even share that as well.
Fine. So I think, yeah. So on behalf of Aura University, we take this opportunity to thank Akul sir for sharing with us this information, and thank all the participants for being with us. And we look forward to your participation again next week. The information will be shared within a day or two with all of you. And you may also like your other colleagues to join this informative sessions with us. For more information, you can reach out to me. My number and my email ID is always with you. So again, on behalf of Aura University, thank all of you. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.